So again, it's not like we have to, you know, strive in any way to get close to God. God's already like, hey, I'm here, I'm waiting. Let's get close. Let's get real with each other. And that's really sweet. So God pulls them out of that discouragement by way of just telling them, okay, go ahead and anoint Elijah to be prophet and the next king over Israel. It says, get back to work. I think most of the time, if we're sitting around idle and feeling bummed out about ourselves, looking inward, I think it's been described, if we look inward, we're troubled. If we look outward, we're distressed. But if we look up, we're in every way encouraged and knowing that God has a good plan for us. So we don't have to be discouraged or dismayed at the things that may come our way. But we are to look up. We are always to look up. Look up to God, see what plans he has for us, and to see who else is around us that we can encourage, that we can strengthen, that we can come alongside. And God did that with Elijah. He says, okay, I want you to come alongside Elijah, anoint him. So he just throws his mantle on him. He says, boom, tag, you're it. You know, have you started looking at the next generation around you and said, hey, tag, you're it? You know, this past weekend, Rochelle had gotten us a seat at Jesus Revolution, you know. Got our whole church to be able to get at the premiere of the movie, Jesus Revolution. And it was so cool because a lot of these brothers and sisters that were saved in the 60s and the 70s, you know, late 60s, early 70s, they went on to be pastors. You know, many of them are actually in the mission field today. They're not just like it was some fad or it was some kind of a revival that sort of sprung up and it diminished. It was a true and real revival of what God's work was doing. So I was out to dinner with David Clark and Shannon the other night, and we were recounting all the things that God has done in our lives. So we're like, isn't that so cool, you know, and how God called all the brothers and sisters that are older than us in the church. And I thought, that is so, so cool, because they answered the call. But then we started, like, thinking about all our brothers and sisters. We thought about, you know, Pastor Mike and Judy, Pastor Paul and Jeannie, of course, Pastor Chuck, and then Raul Reese, and all these pastors that are now pastoring their own churches. And then we thought, hey, how about Dan and Anna, you know? They're missionaries because they answered a call here to go to the mission field in Mexico. Really, Dan left his comforts of being here. I think he was a construction worker. And he heard God's word, and he says, I'm going to go out and serve in Mexico. And he started a life there. So they are still doing it to this day. And they're looking around, too, and they're no spring chickens. They're getting older. And I wonder who they're looking around going, hey, tag, you're it. And I know that they've, you know, what I see so wonderfully happen over the years in this ministry alone at Calvary Chapel Life is that so many pastors have actually gone from here and began to pastor at other churches. You know, so many servants have gone out here and began to serve other places. So I'm really encouraged by what God did and is doing in the life of our brothers and sisters, and anointing them and allowing God to do a work in their lives. And now they're doing it today, even here within the church ministry. You know, a lot of people are serving today because of the call that God had on their lives and saying, hey, I want you to serve, and I'm going to bring older brothers and sisters around you to help you along as you grow in the ministry. So just really exciting. So tonight we're going to be in 1 Kings chapter 20, and these battles are coming Ahab's way, but really he doesn't put up a fight. He doesn't even, you know, he downright surrenders. So in our lives, we got to be careful about the battles that come our way. So why don't I read the first, let's get the first five verses, actually four verses, and then we'll pray. It says, "Now Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, gathered all his forces together. 32 kings were with him, with horses and chariots, and he went up and besieged Samaria and made war against it. Then he sent messengers into the city to Ahab, king of Israel, and said to him, 'Thus says Ben-Hadad, your silver and your gold are mine. Your loveliest wives and children are mine.' And listen to what the king replies. And the king of Israel answered and said, 'My lord, O king, just as you say, I and all that I have are yours.'" Whew. Why don't we pray? Father, we just come before you and we thank you for this evening, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for, Lord, the wind, the storm, the rain, even the snow, Lord, that you've brought in our land. And Lord, definitely California needed the rain. So, Lord, we thank you for being gracious to us in that and to the people that are here and that are yours and to those that are going to be called by your name, Lord. I ask, Father God, that you would continue to do a work in our lives, in our children's lives. And I pray, Father God, that you would encourage us even by tonight's scriptures, Lord, to follow you and to not retreat and to not give up. And I pray, Father God, that you would just bless our time together in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody says, amen. All right. So let's see here. This battle's coming his way. Ahab, this wicked king in Israel, man, he is just a bad dude. So bad things are starting to happen to him, as if they hadn't already happened to him, really. But now Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, gathered all his forces together. 32 kings were with him. Now, If you could see this scene, I want to sort of lay out the land before us. The way they did battle back in the days was these kings would go out and conquer nations, you know, or sometimes even small, you know, towns or tribes or, you know, and they would make them their servants, almost like, hey, I'm going to allow you to continue to be king in your land. But when I call on you and tap you on the shoulder, you got to come out and fight with us. So these kings would come in, roll into town and say, either surrender or die. And if they would didn't put up a fight, then these kings were, okay, we're going to continue to allow you to rule. And even after they would be conquered, they would almost set up like a sort of placeholder king in that place and say, hey, you're going to continue to rule the people because one king can't rule these vast nations or vast territories. So he would keep them in place so they could rule those people. And but again, when duty called and they had to go out to battle, hey, guess what? You're being tapped and you got to get all your army and we're going to go to battle. So this scene is a multitude, not just, you know, so if there's 32 kings, could you imagine how many armies are behind each king? This is not a small army. This is a vast, huge army. I like to see those old movies when, you know, about, you know, the Persian Empire or the Grecian Empire, and they would gather all these troops, and man, it was almost like a sea of people, and they would gather together and maybe they would fight against the Grecians, you know, and or Troy or the Battle of Troy, you know, those kind of movies. And you would see them line up on the other side and they were just arrayed in battle and this armor and just this noise. And you go, wow, these people are crazy to just go out there and they were fighting for these kings, really. And you know, that's war. So this is exactly the way it's laying out here. It says that these 32 kings were with him with horses and chariots. So this is a mighty army. This is not just, you know, some people out there in the, out there with sticks and little swords. They have horses and chariots, so they are well armed, equivalent to, you know, tanks, and equivalent to our armed forces today. There's no messing around. Horses and chariots were like jets and tanks, equivalent to today. Now it says, and he went up and besieged Samaria. Samaria was the capital city in Israel, which Ahab made the capital. You know, at some point he says, "Hey, I want to be king, and I want to be, you know, the man, and I'm going to make this city my own." So, yeah, he's a man, all right, but he has a woman that's leading him, Jezebel. But she's not mentioned in this chapter whatsoever, but he says, and he went up and besieged Samaria. So he's going up against the king Ahab in Israel and made war against it. So he's besieging it. He's right outside the gates. Then he sent messengers into the city to Ahab, king of Israel, and said to him, thus says Ben-Hadad. Okay, he's like, here's my pronouncement to this town. Okay? And here it is, your silver and your gold are mine. Your loveliest wives and children are mine. And he's proclaiming to him either surrender and die, or die. Surrender or die. And he's saying, hey, everything that you have now belongs to me. And one way or another, it's mine. And really, isn't that what the enemy tries to do to us? Comes into our lives and tries to take from us what rightfully belongs to us, what's rightfully given to us by God in our lives. And really, we know the enemy as a, pastors like to say that he's a one-trick pony. But he actually has three tricks up his sleeves. He's out to steal, kill, and destroy. Those are the three that he comes up against us and besieges us with. I mean, if you can describe the enemy roaring around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour, you can almost look and see this lion just roaring around and seeking who's the weak one, you know? Who are the ones that are going to be able to stand up and say, hey, no, I belong to the Lord. And or those that are just going to fold and say, you know what, whatever you want is yours. And really, that is not the life that we want. We want one that is filled with victory, one that is filled with God in our lives, standing for us and battling and warring against the enemy on our behalf. And for us to know that we are in a place of victory. We are fighting from a place of victory, not to victory, you know. One thing is, we are fighting to victory. We're going to have victory eventually. We're going to be able to see this. But you know what? We're already fighting from victory. And you know where that victory was won? Tell me, church family. At the cross. Jesus Christ won our victory for us so that we no longer have to war against the flesh. No longer have to war against the enemy in our life, the devil. So that no longer do we have to war and bow down to the sin that so easily ensnares us, you know? We actually can have victory in those areas of our lives. We don't have to say, here, our silver, what we've been purified with, the blood of Jesus Christ that cost him everything, you know? We no longer have to just surrender and say, hey, him coming our way and trying to act tough, again, because Jesus Christ already won those battles for us. We have to win in our lives to know that we're fighting from victory and allowing those battles to really dissipate in our lives. Now, I'm not going to say that it's not hard, you know. When temptation comes your way, the Bible says that God will always give a way of escape. And I'm thankful for that because we have the ability to say, no, I'm not going to do that. No, I'm not going to go there. No, I'm not going to go that way. But we have the ability to do that. And that's how we can have victory in our lives. So it says, then he sent messengers to the city to Ahab, king of Israel, and said to him, thus says Ben-Hadad, your silver and your gold are mine. Your loveliest wives and children are mine. Proclaiming over him, he is going to be conquered. And the king of Israel, listen to what he answers, and says, my lord, O king, just as you say, and all that I have are yours. Imagine being a wife in his kingdom. Whoa, wait a minute, I didn't agree to this. I don't want to be ruled by somebody else. What are you thinking? And my kids do not belong to anyone else. No, not at all. You know, my wife and my kids belong to the Lord. And I proclaim them to the Lord. And I say, Lord, they're yours. They are yours, Lord. They're your inheritance. And I proclaim my life to be yours. So really, the only person that we should say, my Lord, capital L, just as you say, all that I have is yours, is to God and to God alone. We should have no fear of man. Actually, that is a snare, the Bible says. And we are not to fear men. But Ahab, being the kind of king that he is, hey, he saw an opportunity and he says, hey, I could still be king here, huh? You know, if I just surrender and I just bow down. So let me ask you, maybe those who are listening, what has surrendering to the enemy ever gotten us? Nothing. Nothing but what I've already said, because he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He's not happy with just getting a little bit. He wants it all. And just like God, he's not happy with just having a little bit of us. He wants us all. So to what are we going to bow down in this life? You know, Joshua said to the people of Israel, you choose this day whom you will serve. If you're going to serve the gods of this land, the gods of Baal, you choose this day whom you're going to serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. That's got to be our claim. And we got to say, we are going to do your will, O God, and not surrender, because the enemy is not going to be content. So he figures, Ahab here figures that if he just surrenders, that this king's going to let him be king and stay in place. But really, the enemy, when he sees weakness and he sees somebody that is straying away from the flock and straying away from God, he sees an opportunity and he wants to take that opportunity. Again, think about a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Who's he going to try to devour? The strong Christian that's around the whole rest of the brothers and sisters that are doing God's will and are, you know, hey, the enemy is going to, we have a target on our backs, you know, even those that are doing what God's called them to do. But I'll tell you one thing, if you're prayed up, if you're doing what God's called you to do, even the lies of the enemy, you're able to say, that's a lie. That's a lie. I'm not going to accept that in my life. No way. You know, there's no way that the enemy is going to have a victory. But Ahab figures, I can still be in place here. Then, verse 5, listen to this. So, what do you think Ben-Hadad is going to think here? All right, man, this guy's just going to fold like just really easy under pressure here. Nah, he's a little toothpick. He says, then the messengers came back and said, thus speaks Ben-Hadad. Okay, so this guy speaks a lot. What he proclaims, he wants to see happen, saying, indeed, I have sent you, saying, you shall deliver to me your silver and your gold, your wives and your children. And really, that's what the enemy wants. That's what the enemy wants. If The enemy can destroy a leader within a home. He will also take the children and the wife. We got to be careful of that. Men, we ought to stand up and be the men that God's called us to be. No retreat, no looking back, no compromise. You know, there's going to be weaknesses in our lives, and yes, we are going to fall, and we're going to sin. Repent of those sins and come back to God quickly. I tell you, because you know what? No sooner did the enemy snag you than he's going to go for your wife and your children. And that is the truth. And we got to be careful against that. We got to guard against that as men of God in prayer, praying for our families, praying for our wives, praying for our children, and saying, no, I will not give any ground to the enemy. There is no way that the enemy is going to have any right, like Pastor Mike used to say, no right, no memorial, in the inheritance that God's given us in this place. So I'm thankful that that's what God does in our lives, even for moms and grandmothers and grandfathers in our lives. Hey, we are not to give up on what God's called us to do, not to give up ground at all. Again, he says, so you shall deliver to me your silver, your gold, your wives, your children. But then he says, I see weakness. I smell blood in the water. And this guy's a shark. But he says, but I will send my servants to you tomorrow about this time, and they shall search your house and the house of your servants, and it shall be that whatever is pleasant in your eyes, they will put it on in their hands and take it. Steal, kill, and destroy. And I got to tell you, King Ahab here is in trouble. He is in big trouble because he already folded very easily to this king and gave up anything that belonged to him. If anything really did belong to him, really everything that he had was given to him by God. The people that he was ruling were God's people, not his people. And really what this guy wants is he wants all the choice people in that land and the silver, the gold, then he's going to take it all. And that's what the enemy wants in our lives. So he says, and whatever's pleasant in their eyes, they shall put it in their hands and take it. And so, verse 7 says, so the king of Israel called all the elders in the land and said, notice, please, and see how this man seeks trouble. For he sent to me for my wife, my children, and my silver and my gold. And I did not deny him. See? I mean, he's now calling on the elders. Now, who should Ahab been calling on? He should have been calling on God. He should have been calling on the one that could have delivered him right off the bat. But you know what? He does do something somewhat good here. He calls on the elders. He calls on wisdom. He calls on some help from people that are at least a little bit wiser than him. And it says, it says in verse 8, and all the elders and all the people said to him, do not listen or consent. He says, do not, they give him good counsel here. Do not give up any ground. Do not listen or consent. And really, we are not to listen to the enemy or consent. We are not to compromise in any way and go along with the enemy and whatever he wants to do in our lives. Absolutely not. Therefore, he said to the messengers of Ben-Ahad, tell my lord, the king, he's still trying to treat him nicely, you know. Tell my lord, the king, all that you have sent for your servant the first time I will do, but this thing I cannot do. And the messengers departed and brought back word to him. And then Ben-Hadad sent to him and said, the gods do to me And more also, if even dust is left on Samaria for a handful for each people who follow me. So he's saying, look, we're going to stomp your ground. And the only thing that's going to be left is really not even dust in Samaria. We're going to take it all. So now this guy's gotten so angered by the response that Ahab gave him that he's saying, hey, look, we're going to utterly destroy you. That's pretty much what he's saying. So who is he also going to utterly destroy? He's going to destroy the people of God in that land, the children of Israel. And, you know, if I know God and I know the Lord, he's not going to allow that to happen. No way. He says, I cannot do this. So he says, hey, look, the gods that he trusted, little gods. This is Ben-Hadad's little gods that he trusts in. He says, hey, they do to me, moreover, if I don't honor them. And so that was also a thing with these kings back in that time, is that they fought for land and for honor and all that kind of stuff as well. But also they would fight for their deities, their gods, you know, their little gods. And they'll say, hey, you know, we're going to go out and battle array and whatever gods that they, you know, Zeus and, you know, Baals and all that they trusted in. And so he says, hey, I'm going to, pretty much he swears to his little gods that he's going to do this. Verse 11 says, so the king of Israel answered and said, tell him, let not the one who puts on his armor boast like the one who takes it off. He says, hey, man, be careful. We all put our armor one piece at a time. Kind of like today's terminology, we all put on our pets one leg at a time. So he's boasting ahead of the battle. And what comes what comes with pride? What comes before pride? The folly, right? So this guy is very prideful. He's saying, hey, look, man, we're going to wipe you out. And he sends back word Ahab. And I think Ahab is not taunting him, but he's saying just flat out, stop, don't boast in what you don't have yet, you know. Tell him, let not the one who puts on his armor boast like the one who takes it off. You know, nobody knows who's going to win that battle. Only God knows. So really, he should not boast in the battle being won before the battle's even had here. There's a couple accounts in the Bible that talk about someone who starts building a house and then soon as they start, they realize they don't have enough money to build the rest of it, you know? That's poor planning. That's actually not being diligent. Or those who go out to battle and don't count the cost of what that battle will entail. And really, I don't think that this guy really counted the cost or really thought it all through. But I think that he saw Samaria and he saw these children of Israel as, you know, very small nation, and he thought he could take them over, I'm sure. And it says, and it happened when Ben-Hadad heard this message, and he and the kings were drinking at the command post, that he said to his servants, get ready. And all they got ready to attack the city. So think about it. 32 kings are battle ready. And so he gets them all ready. Suddenly a prophet approaches Ahab, king of Israel, saying, thus says the Lord. And doesn't that sound a lot better than King Ben-Hadad saying, thus says Ben King Hadad, whatever this guy's name is, you know? But when a prophet speaks and he steps into the land, and he speaks with such authority. And really, I'm so thankful that in the time that I've been able to walk with the Lord, I've learned more and more about the strength that God's given me and given us as believers to stand on his word, you know? To stand on the faith that we have. to stand on the promises of God that he's given to us. No longer do we have to go, well, I hope that God will deliver me from this trial that I'm going to be going into. I lost my job. Well, I hope that maybe someday my kids will start walking with the Lord again. Maybe. No, believer. Not at all. We are those that can proclaim. No, God says in his word that we are to train up our kids in the way they should go. And when they when they grow old, they will not depart. Lord, I claim that promise over my kids. Do a work in them now, Lord. Don't let them get to the end of their lives and all of a sudden realize that you are it. Lord, let them serve you at an early age. Train up a child in the way they should go. In the way that God wants to instruct them. You know, I don't have to think about whether God is going to supply my needs, because God has always supplied my needs. So I can lift up my hands in the air and say, Lord, you are the God that provides. In my life, Lord, you've been my provider. Lord, I lost my job, but Lord, I trust you even in this time. So we can proclaim, thus says the Lord. Just like these prophets. I think that sometimes we may, and I don't know about you, I think sometimes I sell myself short when I don't think about those things and the victories that God has given me in the past. Could you imagine how victorious we'd be able to, I don't know, I think we'd be able to go walk around and be like, yep, God's got this. Oh, this trial's coming my way. I don't know, Lord. This is difficult, but Lord, I know that you're in control. You're going to handle this, Lord. Now I'm going to trust you. I'm just going to wait on you, Lord. I've been often encouraged by Miss Judy in my prayers. I said, Judy, I need prayer. I want to, you know, I'm waiting on the Lord for something. And the answer was no. And she goes, oh, Helyn, sometimes God's answers are yes. And sometimes God's answers are no. And sometimes God's answers are wait, you know. And she goes, but sometimes his answers are no, that are good too. So don't despise those. I'm encouraged by that. I know that in my life, if God allows something to happen in my life, it's because he's in control. He can take care of us even when we are, we're not in control. Really, I mean, most of the time I'm out of control. Completely out of control. Most of the things that we think that, or we fear that are going to happen, never happen. You know? The things that we're troubled by, really, if we just give some time, God is able to come in and give us the victory and help us in those times. Maybe even through those times, strengthen our faith and our walk with him. You know, the times that I've been in trouble or in distress or in through a in testing or tribulation or, what is it called? When you're just, you know, going through a valley. Those are the times where I get the most close to the Lord. It's kind of sad, huh? I should be closer to the Lord all the time, even in the times when everything's going great. But you know what? It's on those times that I'm going through some troubled things in my life that I get the most close to the Lord. And what did I start out by saying with Elijah? Is that you have to get really close to God in order to hear him whisper. That still small voice in our lives that says, Helyn, I got this. Helyn, I'm with you. Oh, Lord. Help my kids, Lord, turn to you. Helyn, they're my kids. Oh, Lord, that's right. That's right. They're your kids. Lord, I surrender them to you. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to be a parent over them. But I know, Lord, that you got a plan for their lives. Oh, man, you know. And then you could just sort of say, okay, Lord, I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm going to sit back. I'm going to get some popcorn and just, you know, no, we still pray. We still, you know, Lord, help. But we trust him. So it says, get ready. get ready and attack the city. Verse 13, suddenly a prophet approached King Ahab and says, thus says the Lord, have you seen all this great multitude? He's telling them, hey, can you look at what's here? And I think King Ahab was like, duh. It's a huge army. Behold, I will deliver into your hand today, and you shall know that I am the Lord. That was the message that this prophet proclaimed. See? Even in a time of trouble like this, King Ahab, imagine how God is, even toward King Ahab right now. God is, what does the Bible say about God? How he's long-suffering, right? God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And even to give Ahab this kind of an opportunity, I think if it were me, I would have been like, King Ahab, you're out and bring the next guy in because this guy is pretty bad. But I think God, in his mercy, is thinking about his people in Israel who would get wiped out in this land, not just of Ahab, but also using Ahab, this opportunity to reach Ahab, giving him another opportunity to turn. He didn't turn with all the prophets of Baal getting, wiped out, So, and seeing God's power there, maybe he'll turn with seeing God's power here. We'll see. Maybe not. He says, suddenly a prophet approached and King Ahab saying, thus says the Lord, have you seen all this great multitude? Behold, I will deliver into your hand today, and you shall know that I am the Lord. It wasn't so that Ahab could have claimed victory over this great army, but it was so that King Ahab would have seen that he is the Lord. God is the Lord. So that you shall know that I am the Lord. He is the one and true God. So Ahab said, by whom? Oh, ye of little faith. By whom? And he said, thus says the Lord, by the younger leaders of the providence. Then he said, who will send them, set the battle in order? And he answered, you. So he says, hey, you're going to lead this young company of men, leaders from every providence. And then verse 16 says, then he mustered the young leaders of the providence, and there were 230,000 against this multitude. When it says a multitude, the Bible doesn't hold back. This would have been a sea of people, 32 kings. So he's got 200,000. And after them, he mustered the people and all the children of Israel, there were 7,000. So they went out at noon. Meanwhile, Ben-Hadad and the 32 kings were getting drunk at the command post. At this point, they're like, oh, yeah, this is a done deal. We're just going to send the army in. We're going to just hang out here and party all the time long. Then the young leaders of the providence went out at first, and Ben-Hadad sent out a patrol, and they told him, saying, men are coming out of Syria, so he, out of Samaria. So he said, if they have come out for peace, take them alive. And if they have come out for war, take them alive. I don't think this guy's in his right mind. He said, take them alive either way. I see it like this. He's all drunk. They came out for peace, take them alive. And if they came out for war, take them alive. Did I just mumble? I don't know. I'm sorry, but this guy is bumbling over his words, being drunk at the power that he has, really, and sitting at the command post with these kings. Then these young leaders of the providence went out. Went out of the city with the army, which followed them, and each one killed his man. So the Syrian, that means they did not miss each time they went and fought one after another. And each one killed his men. So the Syrians fled, and Israel pursued them. And Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, escaped on horse with the cavalry. Then the king of Israel went out and attacked the horses and chariots and killed the Syrians with a great slaughter. So this army is delivered. This little army goes out against this multitude. But who's with them? God. God is with them. Just like God is with us. No matter what multitude of things may come our way, God is with us. Amen? And the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You know? So, I don't know what may come your way that may have you in fear. But you know what? To tell you the truth, I think those that are coming your way should be in fear rather than us. We ought to trust in our Lord, our God. Verse 22, and the prophet came to the king of Israel and said to him, go, strengthen yourself, take note, and see what you should do, for in the spring of the year of the king of Syria will come up again against you. So this is not over yet. Okay, this is going to happen again. Let's get going here. It says, then the servants. So I want to let you know that if the enemy comes and attacks once, you better be sure that he'll come again. And sometimes again. And again, and we got to be ready. You know, we have to have the armor of God on for every situation. Verse 23 says, then the servants of the king of Syria said to him, their gods are gods of the hills. So they say, hey, they defeated us. So their God, the children of Israel, their God must be the God of the hills. Because they beat us, they whipped us in the hills. But therefore, they are stronger than we. But if we fight against them in the plain, surely we will be stronger than they. So do this thing. Dismiss the kings, each from his position, and put captains in their place. And you shall muster an army like the army that you have lost, horses for horses and chariots for chariots. Then we will fight again against them in the plains. Surely we will be stronger than they. So they change strategy. The enemy always changes strategy. He says, hey, we can't get them up in the hills, you know, when they're with their with the Lord, with God, you know, with the strength of the believers around them. Hey, why don't we... the enemy thinks, oh, I'm going to change strategies here. Maybe I'm going to get them in the valleys when things are down and out, you know, in the plains, in the open field, when they're out in the world. It says, and he listened to their voices and did so. So it was in the spring of the year. So this prophet was accurate in what he said would happen, that Ben-Hadad mustered the Syrians and went up to Ephek to fight against Israel. And the children of Israel mustered and given provision, and they went against them. Now the children of Israel encamped before them like two little flocks of goats. That's a picture for you, right? Imagine this multitude again comes their way, but they look like two little flocks of goats. While the Syrians filed the countryside. Then a man of God came and spoke to the king of Israel and said, thus says the Lord, because the Syrians have said, the Lord is God of the hills, but he is not the God of the valley. Therefore, I will deliver all this great multitude into your hand, and you shall know that I am the Lord. Again, proclaiming who God is. God is not just the God of the hills. He is also the God of the valley. As a matter of fact, he's also the God of the plains. He's also the God of the world. He is the creator of heaven and earth. Our God is the God of hosts, and that is our God. That is what we can proclaim to our enemy and say, no, you will not have any right, memorial, or inheritance in the work that God is doing in my life at all. And that you can proclaim because God is the God of the valley and the God of the hills. And God is going to demonstrate this so that not just King Ahab can see it, but also the Syrian army that's coming against them, and King Hadad. It says, and they encamped opposite each other for 7 days. So it was that on the seventh day that the battle was joined. And the children of Israel killed 100,000 foot soldiers of the Syrians in 1 day. But the rest fled to Aphek into the city. Then a wall fell on 27,000 of the men who were left. So this battle is brutal. Brutal. And there was no retreat that needed to happen here. And Ben-Hadad fled and went into the city, into an inner chamber. This guy is on the run, and rightly so, for proclaiming God just the God of the hills. God was not going to have that. God is everywhere. You know? So these little deities were only localized back in that time. Well, we believe in the God of the hills. And we believe in the God of the plains. And well, once you stepped outside of that, your God can't do anything for you now. And again, these little gods are fashioned according to their own image. So they can't ascribe too much power to these gods. They got to sort of divvy up the power, you know? But God is all-powerful, all-knowing. But you know what else God is? He's all-loving. He loves you. And he'll take care of you. And he'll go to battle for you. So this guy has fled. Let's finish up here because I got quite a ways to go. I may not finish. It says, then his servant said to him, look, now we have heard that the king of the house of Israel are merciful kings. Please let us put sackcloth around our waist and ropes around our heads and go out to the king of Israel. Perhaps he will spare your life. So they wore sackcloth around their waist and put on rope around their head and came to the kings of Israel and said, your servant Ben-Hadad said, please let me live. So he comes to them, to King Ahab, and says, your servant, listen to this. And he said, is he still alive? He, my brother. That's King Ahab's reply. So this is one thing that you cannot make the enemy. You cannot make the enemy your servant. Because whatever you surrender your life to, or you compromise in your life to that, you become a slave to. You actually become the servant. But then see what King Ahab does here? Instead of calling him a servant and saying, hey, let him come out so I can take his head off. He says, oh, is he alive? My brother. Can we make the enemy our brother? Nope, not at all. Not at all. We are actually told that we are to mortify the deeds of the flesh. You know, this was Saul's great sin, is that he didn't take out the king and all that God had ascribed for him to do when he went in and conquered to wipe them out utterly. It says, verse 33, now the men were watching closely to see whether any sign of mercy would come from him and quickly grasped at his word and said, your brother, Ben-Hadad. See, now they're not like, oh, well, maybe he doesn't even have to be a servant. He could just be his equal, a brother. And really, King Ahab aligned himself with this king, unfortunately, because of the fact that maybe he was so close in the deity that they worshipped, Baal, you know, that he saw him as a brother. How sad, huh? Oh, Lord, let it not ever be so that we would ever stoop so low to worship anything other than you, Lord. Anyone other than you. He says, so he said, go, bring him. Then Ben-Hadad came out to him, and he had him come up into the chariot. So he's bringing him and embracing him into a really a role of prominence. So Ben-Hadad said to him, the cities which my fathers took from your father, I will restore, and you may set up marketplaces for yourself in Damascus, as my father did in Samaria. Then Ahab said, I will send you away with treaty. So he made a treaty with him and sent him away. It was not for King Ahab to make a treaty with this king. Whose victory was it? Was it Ahab's? Not at all. It was God's victory. It was God's battle. And it was to him that it belonged to. All right, let's finish up here. Now, a certain man of the son of the prophet said to his neighbor, by the word of the Lord, strike me, please. And the man refused to strike him. Then he said to him, because you have not obeyed the voice of the Lord, surely as soon as you depart from me, a lion shall kill you. And as soon as he left him, a lion found him and killed him. Now, what's going on here? So this prophet is by the road, and he calls out to somebody. He says, hey, strike me. And the guy doesn't do it. He doesn't obey this prophet. And immediately, his disobedience led to his downfall. And may I say to you, even today, a lot of the disobedience that's going on in our world right now, it has huge consequences. You know, right now, we have a fentanyl epidemic that is not even being called out to. And people are literally dying from one pill of fentanyl. And that is a choice that they are making, and they are succumbing so quickly to that drug. And I'm telling you, it's so crazy, because back, you know, we at least had room for error back then. But now, today, there's no way. I mean, the first time you try drugs today could be your last. And the willful disobedience of this generation and these people that are all around us. And really, we have an opportunity to reach out to people and say that's not the way to go. So again, we don't allow any room for the enemy or make any treaty with the enemy. So this prophet, I think, is bringing about a message here. So let's listen in. Verse 37. And he found another man and said, strike me, please. So the man struck him, inflicted a wound. Then the prophet departed and waited for the king by the road and disguised himself with a bandage around his eye. Now, as the king passed by, he cried out to the king and said, your servant went out into the midst of the battle. And there a man came up and brought a man to me and said, guard this man. If by any means he is missing, your life shall be for his life, or else you shall pay a talent of silver. While your servant was busy here and there, he was gone. Then the king of Israel said to him, so shall your judgment be. You yourself have decided it. And then he says, and he hastened and took the bandage away from his eyes, and the king of Israel recognized him as one of the prophets. Then he said to him, thus says the Lord, because you have let slip out of your hand a man who was appointed to utter destruction. Therefore, your life shall go for his life. That was God's command over him. It was almost like a Nathan the prophet moment. Aha, you're the man, King Ahab. A man was entrusted to him. That man was the king of Assyria. And he was to utterly wipe that guy out. Because no sooner than he lets this guy go that he'll come back up again. And that's exactly what the enemy would do. Again, let me say, we are to mortify, put to death the deeds of the flesh. We are not to allow any room or board, nothing, not a crumb for the flesh, for the enemy, or for sin in our lives. You know, that is a battle. And we are in a real battle. And we got to understand that. That we have to have that kind of responsibility over what God's given us. So he says, hey, I entrusted this to you. God's entrusting, really what God's given us is this great faith in him to know that he's able to take us out of any situation and say, Lord, I'm just going to trust you. I'm not going to do what this world is doing. I want to do what you want me to do. So this guy comes out of his disguise and says, aha, you're the man. And he tells him, look, you were supposed to utterly destroy this king, and you did not. He was entrusted to you. Then the king, while your servant was busy here and there, he was gone. I read that already. Thus the Lord says, because you have let slip out of your hand a man who I appointed to utter destruction, therefore your life shall go for his life. So that's pretty much pronouncing over him, his days are numbered. And your people for his people. So the king of Israel went to his house, solemn and displeased, and came to Samaria. And may I tell you, was there any repentance in this king? Did he say, hey, no, prophet, I'm sorry. Please, I want to plead before the Lord and ask for forgiveness. None of that's here. As a matter of fact, he's like the people or those that are sorry for getting caught doing what they did, rather than truly being sorry in their hearts. They go away sorry, but they're not sorry. That's it. They just go away sorry. Sorry in a pity potty, and he's going to go home and be a bugaboo. And that's how this is going to end tonight. Pretty crazy, huh? But the battle is who? The Lord's. The battle is the Lord's. And that's what we learned from this this account. In 1 Kings chapter 20, is that the battle belongs to the Lord. In our lives, in our wives' lives, in our children's lives, in our children's children's lives, you know, that is territory that God hallows. Wherever we set foot is holy ground. I like to think about that like that. A brother once told me, he goes, I go, yeah, there's this kid coming and, you know, he doesn't know the Lord, and you know he's a little wayward. He goes, hey, well, he came into holy ground, so either he's going to change, or he's going to have to change direction and either stick with the Lord or go. So you know what? God is faithful. God is always faithful to his people. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you. We thank you, Lord, for you being the God of the hills, the God of the valleys, the God of the plains. You are our great God, our Savior. We thank you, Lord, for all the work that you've done in our lives. We know, Lord, that the work that you've begun in us, you'll complete until the day of Jesus Christ. Lord, we proclaim that work, that faith, that trust that we have in you because of not just past victories, Lord, but because we're fighting from victory, from the victory we had at the cross, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sins. And thank you, Lord, for fighting our battles. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to go at it alone, but you'll be with us wherever we go, Lord. You'll never leave us nor forsake us. And for that, Lord, we're so thankful. We love you and we thank you. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody says,
amen.
Amen.